Excellent. So it is 3 minutes past 10. So shall we get started this morning?
Let's indeed. Do either of you guys have any exciting announcements to make?
All I was going to say, if I can, is we've a calendar competition and we've extended the deadline because we want a few more entries. And there's some amazing prizes. There's €50 one for all vouchers for the winners. And there's calendars that will be given to the schools that participate, or certainly that win. And information's on our website, info@dublinbaybiosphere.ie. So that would be really good to get some more entries, because we want to have a fantastic calendar. And it's or to, what you need to do is produce artwork that showcases our biosphere. So either the wildlife that you can find there, or the culture, or the people, anything, what people do. So yeah, lots of opportunities. Thank you, Nessa, for that.
And may I suggest that people explore different types of art materials? I mean, we made bees out of fruit a couple of weeks ago, so
There's an
the
idea.
possibilities are endless.
There's an idea. Fantastic.
That is exciting. We are just about to announce the winners of our calendar competition down here in Kerry. So we had a Birds of the Biosphere competition this year. So primary school students submitted images that they had created of all different kinds of birds that you can find in Kerry. So keep an eye on our social media and our website. We'll be announcing the selected entries and having the calendar designed next week, which is very exciting. I
Wow,
love
that's
these
great.
calendars because the artwork is just amazing.
You get to enjoy it year round.
Exactly, yes,
And
exactly.
I'm drinking out of my goldfinch mug today, which is very appropriate.
Okay, so let's go.
Let's go,
So
yes,
many
because there's a
keen
lot.
children need to learn about insects as well as us.
True. Okay, so if anyone who hasn't been with us the last 4 weeks, I'm Nessa Darcy. I'm a creative entomologist, and my mission is to reintroduce humans to their natural habitats through colorful encounters with insects. I do have some slides here somewhere. Oh, I forgot to open them. Bear with me. Last week we were talking about exploring insects through the sense of smell, and this week we're going to be talking about how to explore them through the sense of touch. And sadly, it's going to be our last of the five webinars. So I'm so sorry, I can't find this. You guys talk amongst yourselves for a second. Tell some more jokes, Dean.
Does Dean have any jokes? Put you on the spot there, Dean.
I've won. Why are there no headaches in the jungle?
Oh, I know this one.
I see. Okay. Well, the answer is because of the paracetamol, which is a really bad joke. It's a really bad joke. I'm sorry about
Excellent. Here we
that.
are. If only I'd found it just a couple of minutes earlier. Uh-oh. Okay, here we are. So we are exploring insects through the sense of touch today. So that we use our skin to feel the world around us, to find our way around and identify things. Where's full screen? There is full screen. Okay. So there's me doing some creative entomology stuff. This is a workshop I did on insects and healing because insects are involved in a lot of or they have a lot of benefits for our health, and they have a lot of interesting ways of healing themselves and each other. And there's a close-up of a little coloring sheet that I made for whale skull Escariida, who I visited last week, and an insect that appeared in my bag when I got home, which obviously had hopped in during our insect hunt, and was still alive 2 days later when I opened my bag. So does anyone know what that green insect is at the bottom? Anyone out there in the chat box? It's something that eats aphids, so it's a really helpful one to have in the garden. It is, in fact, a green lacewing. So last week you also asked me, why do snails have different colored shells? And I didn't know the answer at the time, but I did a little bit of reading and found out that most of the variation is because of genetic differences, the same way that we have different colored hair and different colored eyes. But scientists have also found that most of This species here, Chepaea nemorellis, most of these types of snails in the cities are yellow, whereas outside of the cities, they can be more pink and brown. And that is to do with the warmer microclimate in a city than there is outside. So the pale color of the shell reflects more light and keeps the snails nice and cool. So thank you for that interesting question. And if you have any more interesting questions this week, just pop them in the Q&A box and we'll hopefully get to them by the end of the webinar. So take a look at this beautiful fluffy moss carder bumblebee. Can you imagine what this fluffy little creature must feel like? Imagine if this was a human-sized bee and you could give it a hug. It would be like a teddy bear. So of course, not all parts of the bee are cute and fluffy and cuddly. What do you think that the bee uses to defend herself from predators? Oh, we're very quiet out there in the chat box today. A sting, exactly, yes. A stinger. And do all of the different bees have stingers? So in the nest, you've got the queen, you've got the workers, you've got the males who are the drones. And so people are saying no. So I'm wondering, in that bee's nest, which are the ones that don't have stingers? Exactly. Someone says the males don't. And that's because the stinger is an adapted ovipositor, which is what the queen uses to lay her eggs. So if you can identify a male bee, you can very safely hold that on your hand and pet it and see how furry it is without getting stung. So on my next slide, I have a few bumblebees. And this, the big picture here on the left, that's a picture of a male, I think it's Bombus lapidarius, and it has a yellow fluffy face. So a lot of the male bumblebees have a yellow fluffy face. I think there's one where the female also does, so just make sure you know which one that is before you go cuddling bees. But this one is certainly safe to handle. But bumblebees are generally quite gentle anyway, so if one lands on your arm and it's happy to walk along, it's not going to do you any harm at all. So the other great thing about fluffy bumblebees is that a lot of pollen sticks to their hair. So you can see on the top right here, this bumblebee is absolutely covered from head to toe in pollen, and that makes them really effective pollinators. And at the bottom there, you've got a tomato flower, and tomatoes can only be pollinated by something that can vibrate them. So they'll only release their pollen when they're vibrated. And the bumblebee has a very special technique of pollinating where it buzzes very vigorously to release the pollen. So here we have some beetles. Actually, do you know what? Before we skip our bees, I want you to take a look around you and see if there's anything that might feel like a fluffy bee. So maybe you've got a nice woolly jumper, possibly not on a warm day like today, but even a soft fluffy t-shirt, and you can maybe feel what the soft furry bee would feel like. Or perhaps you've got short hair and you can feel that. Or your eyebrows are a bit like the hairs on the bee. They're actually not real hairs like human hairs. They're called setae or setae. They're like little bristles, but they're quite soft. So here we have beetles. What do you think the beetles feel like? Is there anything around you on your desk or in the classroom that might feel like the hard, shiny exoskeleton of a beetle? I've got a biro here, and I can feel the ridges on the biro. That's quite like the ridges on the back of the ground beetle at the bottom there. People are saying that the bees might feel hard and dry. Yeah. Silk, very nice. Yeah, because some of them are quite smooth, aren't they? And they're quite hard. They have a tough, wing cases. Oh yeah, Dean's got his phone case there. That's an excellent comparison, because they have these hard wing cases to protect their wings. And so there's a particular type of beetle here in the large picture on the left. And this one does something very interesting when you touch it. Does anybody have any idea how that beetle reacts when you touch it? Oh, and someone's saying that they feel like smooth stone. That's very nice. There's a few questions coming in as well. I lost one that I saw earlier. Why do bees have...
Somebody suggested that it might change colour. It's a good guess.
Oh, that's an interesting one, but I'm afraid it doesn't. That would be cool, though.
Another one says it might bite you.
I don't think this particular one would, but that other big black ground beetle at the bottom there might.
So you've got vibrates or jumps?
If you really bothered it. Vibrates or jumps, yeah.
It releases a bad smell.
Oh, good ideas. Yeah, it does jump, indeed. It makes a click noise and it jumps quite far and like quite hard. Like if you were in the way, it would kind of hit you. So it's called a click beetle, and that's how it startles away predators if they're bothering it. I'll answer those couple of questions that I saw in there. Why do bees have long tongues? That's so they can reach right into the inside of the flower to get to the nectar. So some flowers have grown, evolved in a way that they deliberately have long flower shapes so that the bee has to get right in there to get its tongue into the nectar. And then that helps it to get pollen onto the bee. But some sneaky bees have realized that they can just bite a hole in the bottom of the flower and drink the nectar out there without having to go to the trouble of struggling into the flower. So it's a constant sort of battle for getting to resources the most easy way. And somebody else had asked, how can you tell the difference between a male and female bee? So I know with bumblebees, many of the males will have yellow fluffy faces. There are certainly other ways that you can tell, but I actually don't know them off the top of my head. And someone has said, why do bees need so many eyes? So as far as I understand, some of the eyes on the top of their head are for gauging light and helping them to navigate based on the sun and different types of light. Again, I would need to do a bit more research on that, but I think that's what those extra eyes are for. All right, so that's beetles. And if you found something near you that you can feel that would be like a beetle, you can imagine that you have a beetle there in your classroom. This fella is a type of shield bug. By looking at him and his features, what kind of shield bug do you think this would be? What do you think what would be a good name for this shield bug? And while you're answering that, I'm going to answer more questions. You got some great questions today. Can bees bite us? I believe they cannot. I've never heard of anyone being bitten by a bee, but they do have these kind of chewing mouths for some of them cut leaves, or some of them will cut like holes in the wax in their hives, that kind of thing.
We've some amazing answers coming in for the shield bug. We've got leaf bug. We've got hairy shield bug, we've got caterpillar shield bug, autumn bug, tiger shield bug.
They're lovely names.
Stink bug, toad bug.
Toad bug.
Oh, some really great nice names coming in for these.
And the first one that came in is the correct one, the hairy shield bug. Oh, wow. So this shield bug actually has quite downy hair on its back. You see that. So what the small one on the right, that is especially downy. So you can feel that and it feels almost velvety. And right now I'd say if you can feel your arms and the very downy hair on your arms, that's probably what it would feel like to be petting a hairy shield bug.
We had an Ogronia bug. Now, wasn't that a pirate?
Oh, Grania whale.
Yeah.
Yeah, cool. There are more questions coming in, but I would ask you maybe if you could put them in the Q&A box, so we can keep track of them and answer them towards the end of the webinar. Otherwise, I'm going to lose them, because you've got really amazing questions today. So that's our hairy shield bug. Now, so all of those insects feel very nice, but not everything out there does. So let me just have a peek at my notes. Yeah, so generally insects don't encourage humans and other enormous terrifying monsters like us to touch them. Their wings and their legs can be very delicate, so they don't want to get excuse me, injured or eaten. And we have to handle them very, very gently. But there are some insects that have evolved spectacular, sensational strategies and structures on their bodies to make us feel very bad if we poke them in the exoskeleton. So things that would actually make our skin irritated or hurt us in some way. If you know any of these amazing defense techniques, put them in the chat box now. We can chat about them. But there's one that is really, really spectacular. And I'm going to show you video of it actually and see if you know its name. Where is it? As usual, I want to show you two many different things and they're all over the place, but here we go. Praying mantis having a little munch on it, but it reacts very strongly and escapes.
Okay, Nessa, you're gonna have to tell us what it did, because I thought it was dinner, I'm gonna be honest.
Yeah, true. I think it did as well for a while. It sprayed a substance called benzoquinones at the praying mantis. And not only is that a very irritating substance, but it has a chemical reaction that makes it up to 100 degrees in temperature as well. So it's boiling, irritating liquid that it's spraying in the face of this poor praying mantis who's just trying to have a bite to eat. And that is the bombardier beetle. So sadly, we don't have that beetle in Ireland, but excuse me. But we do, I got sprayed by a bombardier beetle earlier, that's why I'm, no, I'm just kidding. I was at, I was visiting a school yesterday and we were all very excited about the bugs, so I lost my voice.
So we do have some answers actually that have come in, which is good. I mean, you've got obviously the bee, which has a stinger, so really good answer. Tarantulas have hair, which causes a reaction. That's one of the suggestions. Another. They shoot silk. Some have spiky bodies, stingers, and use noises.
Oh yeah, very good. Yeah, yes. We talked about that in our sound webinar, didn't we?
Yeah, we got some smart cookies here.
Huh? Excellent. So this is a picture of the bombardier beetle, and beside it there's a picture of a beetle that we do have in Ireland called Encomenus dorsalis, a type of ground beetle, which has very similar colours to the bombardier beetle, so that things will think that it can spray them like that and they'll be scared to go near it, whereas actually it's only mildly irritating compared to the bombardier beetle. So some imitate dangerous insects. That's, someone got that answer in just before I told you about the bombardier beetle mimic there. So that's excellent. Now, we've established that bumblebees are fluffy and very docile and feel nice and soft. You might look at this furry thing here and think that it might be nice and cuddly as well, but this is actually the egg mass of the white, the yellow-tailed moth, and she's covered the eggs in irritating hairs from her body to protect them against predators. And that's the caterpillar at the bottom there. And those caterpillars have irritating hairs. So if they're bothered by a predator, the hairs will break off, and they even have some irritating liquid inside them that will make your skin sting and maybe go red and lumpy. So the hairy caterpillars are still have adorable nicknames like Hairy Mollies, or in Irish, Siobhanín an Clúb, which means little Siobhan of the hairy coat. But if they're really bothered, they're not so sweet. This is one that I met in Madagascar, who you'd think that I would have noticed him on the leaf, but I brushed past him and got jabbed by his spikes as well. And that was very painful. Still very cool caterpillar. And these are oak processionary moth caterpillars. So as you can see, they go along in a procession, a long line of caterpillars. And they do that to when they're ready to pupate, ready to turn into a cocoon. One of the caterpillars will lead the other caterpillars. She's usually a female caterpillar, and they'll go and find somewhere really nice to pupate, to hide and pupate until they turn into moths. So while they're doing this, they're like touching so that they can keep track of each other. So they're head to bum, keeping in contact with each other to follow each other along. And we're going to have a go of this, probably not head to bum, maybe hands on shoulders instead. We're going to do a caterpillar conga line around the classroom. So I'm going to prepare the dance floor, but in the meantime, so you get the full effect, I would say just close your eyes for now, okay? And I'm going to get this set up so you can enjoy the full effect of a caterpillar conga line.
And the children are going to be doing this in their classrooms, is that right?
Yeah, that's right.
Ooh, okay.
Okay, one moment. When the music starts, you can open your eyes and get up and start congaing around your classroom, if that's a verb. I'm not sure if it is. Oh, one moment. Technical issues. I hope this works. A bit of an experiment. Shake your body, baby, do that conga. No, you can't control yourself any longer. Come on, shake your body, baby, do that conga. No, you can't control yourself any longer. Is the video working?
Thank you.
someone got lost at the end. Dean looks worn out. Remember, you've all got to keep in contact so you caterpillars don't get lost.
Well, everyone was saying they were having fun, and I know I did.
Good.
There was a couple of good
too.
Questions that came through.
That was awesome.
How many caterpillars in a line?
Ooh, that's a good question. Yeah. I found a video earlier which had 190 caterpillars in it, but I imagine you could probably have more.
Yeah. Well, I felt sorry for that one that got lost. I hope he found his way back.
I hope so too. These types of caterpillars, there can be hundreds and hundreds of them all in one tree, and they build a kind of silk web to protect themselves. So yeah, there'll be a lot galloping along in that line.
Okay.
Well done. Thanks everyone for getting into that. You can all settle back down in your seats now, because we have some, we got some compliments there. The three of you should be full-time dancers. I'm not sure if that's a compliment for our dancing or an insult for our insect workshop presentation.
Actually, there was a question, do all caterpillars do this? And I suspect it's only a few, is it?
Only the processionary caterpillars. So there are a few different types, pine, oak, there's some species in Africa as well. Other ones do. I've seen small tortoise shell caterpillars, they'll just suddenly decide on the same day that they want to go off and pupate. They've had enough to eat, they've eaten enough nettles, and they are, they just suddenly all leave the nettle patch, but they don't tend to walk in the line, but you can see them just like exiting the scene and going to find safe little places.
A lot of the classes said they had great fun. One said, did they imagine an extremely cute puppy? Well, that was Benjamin Fluff, and he was helping me do the conga. So, well, no, they didn't imagine that. He was
and he looked like a hairy caterpillar as well.
Yeah.
So I have some other exciting special guests. We've had Benjamin Fluff, and we also have some more slimy characters to introduce you to. They are sensational stunt performers. So they can pop their eyes in and out of their heads. They can walk upside down on a ceiling, carrying a whole house on their back. They have 14,000 teeth inside their mouths. And they can make death-defying journeys over sharp, dangerous objects. Can anybody guess who our special guests are?
They sound like superheroes, if you ask me.
Yes.
Hmm. We've got answers coming in.
Oh, you're very
it's
clever.
It's unanimous.
Snails.
Lots of snails.
Maybe it's because you already know that you have some special guests in your own classroom today. Some of your brave teachers may have gone out in the rain last night and collected some special guests for yourselves. So you can bring them out, because we're going to see what kind of stunts they can perform. And I'm going to mess around with some technology here and see if I can introduce you to my three snails I have here. So here we have Federico Garcia. Oops, which way do I hold this? Not that way. And Lorca. And these are my professional stunt snails. So today we're going to start off by putting them into the circus ring. Excuse me, Lorca. Oops. Good thing they have those strong shells on their back. And if they're willing, oh, you see that Garcia is producing some bubbles and slime. That's his way of telling me that he doesn't want to be handled. Oh, lots of bubbles. So once they're on in the circus ring, they're gonna be popping out their eyes to explore their new territory. And this first stunt, if you have your snails there on the desk as well, is to bring your finger very close to their eye stalks and watch what happens when you tip them. Oh, it's not as dramatic as I was expecting, Garcia. Let's try Federico. They can pop their eyes right back into their head. And they do this by pumping blood in and out of the eye stalks. They're all pretty chill, actually. They don't seem too bothered. But there you go. That's how they do that. You can see that Lorca is one of the Chepea nemoralis snails that we saw at the start that have all the different multicolored shells. Their common name is the brown-lipped snail. You can see that brown line at the edge of their shell. And these guys are common garden snails. They're the ones that we said you could eat. Oh, sorry, guys.
I think Frederico's found some dinner.
Yeah, it looks like it. That's some lettuce I borrowed off my housemate, so hopefully she won't watch this before I tell her that I borrowed it. Now let's see their ability to climb upside down. How am I going to do this with the phone in my hand? To climb upside down while holding their house on their back. So I will just hold this like this. Let's borrow you for a moment, Garcia. Now you see how he stuck to the circus ring there. They have very sticky stomach feet. That's what they walk around on. They have a stomach foot, and that's where they get the scientific name gastropods. So, which way up is this? So he is actually upside down now. My camera doesn't want to recognize that. What's happened?
Yeah, the camera's gone, but we did see it upside down. So
good.
It was able to carry its house on its back upside down. Wow.
And that's quite a heavy house. He's a good solid snail. So there you go. Death-defying, gravity-defying feats. Now, next up, we're going to find out about their 14,000 teeth. I bet you didn't think that snails had so many teeth. Well, their teeth are actually arranged in rows on their tongues. So instead of biting, they actually rasp. They'll rasp the surface of the leaves, and that's how they eat. And we can see that Federico is doing that right now. But it's not in focus. If you have your snails handy in the classroom, I would encourage you to place them onto your hand. And if you're lucky, they might try and taste you with their 14,000 teeth. So I'm just going to pop Garcia onto my hand. And I used to have pet giant African land snails, and you could really feel them rasping your hand when you held them. But we say, oh yeah, I can feel it. It tickles. So he's tasting my hand, I suppose, to find out if it's a leaf. He's just decided that it's not. And so he's now galloping slimily away in the direction of the lettuce. But you can really feel the, those tickly teeth rasping on your skin. And of course, this lovely slime, which is, it's a really important substance for them, because when snails that lived in the sea evolved to come onto land, they had to find a way to survive being dry. And so they produce lots and lots of slime constantly to keep themselves moisturized. And that's why you tend to find them in darker, damper places as well, because if they stay out in the sun for too long, they can get dried out. These guys I've just found last night on my way home in the rain. So we'll pop Garcia back down into the circus ring. And we have one more incredible stunt to perform. Now I just need a little bit of a setup. So bear with me a moment. And maybe we can answer some of those questions while I'm figuring that out. Oops.
Nessa, whilst you're doing that, we've had a question come in, and it would be a quick, easy one to answer. Can snails swim?
Oh, that's a good question.
Mm. With a house on their back, I mean, I would have thought not.
I've never seen land snails swimming. Could be wrong, but I have seen water snails kind of swimming along the surface of the water. So they actually use the surface tension of the water to be able to move along.
Very good.
So that's it's handy having that kind of like flat, almost fluid stomach foot to avail of surfaces like that, even the surface tension of the water. So bear with me a moment while I set up the circus ring. Actually, teachers, if you were brave enough or crazy enough to bring in the item that I mentioned on your resource from your kitchen drawer, now is the time to set it up sharp side up. You can hold it in place with some blobs of blue tack.
So whilst you're doing that, there's another question. Why do praying mantises jump so high? And I actually didn't know that they could jump.
Yeah, me neither. Well, that's a good question. I suppose they're hunters, so they would need to pounce on their prey. And sometimes they can catch quite big things, so they really need to be able to get a good grip on it and surprise it as well before it jumps away. So I say it's to do with speed and needing to get on top of things and pin them down. Okay, we're ready to go. Which of the snails would you like to see performing this death-defying feat? Federico, Garcia, or Lorca? Oh, we've got Garcia. Federico.
Garcia gets the vote, 2-1.
He votes for Garcia.
Poor Garcia.
Okay. Oh. Yeah, he's had to go through a lot today. Although he was the one who proved himself brave by hanging onto the ceiling with a house on his back. So certainly seems like he'd be the one able to do this. Okay, I've got Garcia in my hands. He's preparing for his adventure. I need to switch on the cameras again. And the stage lights. Maybe it is on. Maybe you can give us a drum roll, Dean and Eleanor, as Garcia is about to traverse the blade of my kitchen knife. Now this knife is very, very sharp. I almost cut the tip off my finger with it the other day.
You should always be careful with knives now, Nessa.
This is true. But snails are braver than me. Snails don't mind just, he's so stuck to my thumb. Snails don't mind just walking along. Uh-oh, we've lost the camera. That was too much suspense. Okay, let's get this going. All right. So because they're so slimy, they can manage to walk along the surface of a knife without a single scratch. Wow, he's really going for it. It's where I trained these guys. But they're just naturally amazing. Go, Garcia, go, Garcia.
Ah, no, he's sensible. He's going down the side. I thought we were going to have two snails for a minute. I was very worried.
No.
Okay, so.
Oh, he's back on the sharp side of the knife. Is anybody else carrying out this death-defying stunt in their classroom? How's it going for you?
So waiting for answers to come in. Whilst they're coming in, there's a couple of quick questions. Can snails communicate with each other?
Oh,
I noticed they were Garcia and Lorca were quite close to each other, and they seem to be feeling each other with their antenna. So I'm assuming that was some form of communication going on there.
Oh, that's a good question. Well, they certainly need to communicate in order to mate. So they actually. Snails are both male and female, but they do need a pair of snails to mate to produce eggs. Now, Garcia and Lorca, was it Garcia and Lorca or Garcia and Federico?
It was Garcia and Lorca.
I'm amazed that you remember their names. They are actually two different species, so I don't know what they would have been talking about. It's possible. Now, snails are omnivorous, so it's possible that Garcia was thinking about eating Lorca or vice versa. But I would say that the main reason that snails would communicate was related to mating. I'm not sure, but I don't think they're otherwise particularly sociable. They would congregate together because they might like the same places to keep damp and cool. I'm sorry, my camera keeps.
That's okay. So another question for snails: can they survive a high fall?
Probably not. Their shells not good for the shell. I think, but they can heal their shells.
Oh, so maybe
they will. They will sort of harden back again, but they may be a different shape. You might see some cracks and changes in shape. Now, Lorca is going to give this a shot as well. I hope. Camera goes off just at the crucial moment. Lorca has fallen off the knife.
No. There are some birds that eat snails by breaking their shell and they like crash them on a rock. So I think you would have to be careful with your shell or your snails not to drop them too much, because if their shell gets broken too much, then they can't heal it.
She's too busy eating that leaf.
She's too hungry.
Sorry.
I think she needs her. She's hungry, and she's obviously littler than the other two. So.
Oh, and Garcia is just making a run for it.
Wow. Good job, Garcia. Now, Nessa, unfortunately, I'm going to have to go because I've got another meeting that I have to attend, unfortunately. So I want to just say thank you for an amazing series. I've really enjoyed it. And thank you to all the classes that have joined us and all those that will watch it at a later date on YouTube. It's been great fun. And hopefully we'll have some more in the not too distant future. If there's any interest, do let us know at info@Dublin Bay Biosphere if there's any kind of workshops that you'd like to participate in. And we'll see if we can make that happen. But for now, I have to go. So thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Dean.
Thanks, Dean.
Bye. Round of applause for Dean.
Excellent work, Dean. So Nessa, if you're free, do you want to stay on for another few minutes? Because there is a few questions coming through in the Q&A. Now, I know a lot of the classes probably have to go because they usually have a break as well. So that's totally fine. But if we answer some of the questions, then they'll be in the recording afterwards for everyone. Is that okay?
Sure. We also have one more poem left after our poetry writing adventure the other day. So I'll read that out and then we'll answer some more questions. Oh, 1 second, sorry. What am I doing? Too many things. There we go. So we're back to our caterpillars. So we have, you remember a couple of weeks ago, we wrote some poems about insects and everyone sent in some lines and we put them together. So we have one more poem made up of your beautiful lines. And this is about noticing nature. The butterfly flies all day and all the bees, they buzz. For when the flowers all come out, they notice that it's spring. All insects make some kind of noise, a flirting chirp, a hiss, a click. Some hunt like dragonflies, like wasps and bees, some sting. Ladybirds are quiet, but the caterpillar munches. Here's a wasp, it's lost a wing, against the window, bing, bing, bing. So well done everyone for that beautiful poetry. And also, if, before everyone has to go, and I will still answer some questions after this, don't worry. There was, I wanted to say thank you because there, so many of you joined in and got really involved in this, but it would have been great to be able to see you in person and to be able to say goodbye to you in person. So instead of me being able to hug all 2,000 of you or however many there are, I want you all now to turn to yourselves and give yourselves a big hug. Tell yourselves you're absolutely amazing and lovely. Big squeeze. Thank you. So any more questions? And we can answer those before I head off.
Yes, there are so many questions coming in now, actually.
Brilliant. So,
the first one, I suppose, let's start with an easier one. What is the difference between a slug and a snail? Is it just the shell?
It is, I think, mainly the shell. Yes. A lot of snails. So let me see which way around this is. Yeah, slugs used to be snails. So they evolved from snails and some of them still have small shells inside their bodies. So kind of remnant shells. And I suppose the difference is with the snail can keep all its guts, its precious guts inside its shell. Whereas the slug is, its guts are kind of spread out more through the body. Yeah.
Okay. And what do slugs eat?
Oh, slugs will eat a lot of different kinds of plants and also dead decaying plant matter. They'll also eat some decaying animal matter as well, I think. They're quite omnivorous and they scavenge. Also, I used to keep pet snails and, I put some paper in the tank for some reason and the snails ate the paper. So they eat some really odd things.
They're really not fussed about what they're eating then.
No. I gave them some strawberries last night and they do seem to have nibbled at those as well.
They've enjoyed the strawberries.
Yeah.
So what are the two small horns on a snail called if the long ones are the eyes?
That's a really good question. And I don't know the answer. if you can find out, let me know. That would be great. I think there's some kind of sensory antennae, but obviously they're not insects. So they're different from what insects have.
Cool. Is there a collective name for a group of snails? That's a good question.
Oh,
I wonder. I don't know.
I don't know the answer, but I would love to hear some suggestions of what that would be called.
What could we call a collective of snails?
A circus troupe of snails.
A circus troupe. There's another question here about if snails can carry disease. Is there any concern about snails and disease?
They can apparently carry a rat lungworm, which doesn't sound very pleasant. But if you're planning on eating your snails, you can keep them for a few days beforehand and they'll clear out their guts. And obviously, generally speaking, if you've been handling animals of any sort, like insects and snails, you should wash your hands afterwards before you eat anything.
That's always important, isn't it? No matter what you're handling, always wash your hands before you eat your lunch or your snacks.
Yes.
We have another Dorcas question that's come in
tasting
here.
The blue tech, and now he's tasting Garcia. So what's
he's
going on?
He's adventurous in his food choices. So Wendy has said that they found a large black slug eating a small New Zealand flatworm.
Wow.
We didn't think anything ate flatworms. So do you have any comment on that?
That's exciting. I would say if anything is going to eat a flatworm, it would be a large slug. Once when I had those pet slugs and snails in the same box, one of the snails had a broken shell and the slugs ate him. So yeah, they'll eat a lot.
So the snails are really get into it.
So that's a good sign, because flatworms eat our earthworms, as far as I'm aware. There's some issue with them. So if we can get the slugs to eat them, that'll keep things in balance.
Fantastic. So a few people actually answered our what is a group of snails called, and it is a root of snails.
A root of snails?
Yeah, like R-O-U-T-E, like a root.
Oh, that's cool.
Thank you very much. Wendy and Amy both sent in the answer to that one, so thank you for that.
Love that.
Now we have a question about bees. I know we started off the webinar talking about bees. Sure. How do bees make honey?
Oh, so they collect the nectar in their honey stomachs, separate from their main stomach. And then they regurgitate that into a cell in the hive. And I think when it's been inside their body, it's mixed with enzymes. So that makes the honey extra healthy. Then they will, they'll beat their wings a lot in the hive, and that I think that warms things up a bit, so it evaporates some water from the honey. Mm-hmm. So nectar is actually much waterier than honey, mm-hmm. much more watery than honey. Mm-hmm. But when they evaporate the water, that's how it becomes thicker and stickier.
Awesome. Bees are amazing with all their, like, it's like they have advanced technology in their hives to make
Absolutely.
Honey, don't they? They're super, super smart. We have a question here about how do you know if a snail is male or female?
They're actually both male and female. Each one is both. It's called hermaphrodite. So there's no need to tell the difference.
That makes it nice and easy, doesn't it?
Yeah.
They're doing some awesome stunts there on the knife still, aren't they?
Aren't they? Yeah.
Right. And the last question then, this is quite an open-ended question. What do you know about ants that live in Ireland? Is there any top facts you want to share about ants in Ireland?
There was something I wanted to share with you in relation to the sense of touch, actually. If you can find an ant's nest and you have bluebells, or this might work with other blue flowers, I'm not sure. And you take a bluebell and you tap the ants with the bluebell, they'll spray their formic acid onto the bluebell thinking it's a predator. And you can see where they've sprayed it, the blue turns to pink. It's like a litmus paper test. So the acid turns the blue to pink. What else do I know about ants? I actually need to do more research in ants, I must confess. I don't know them that well. But we do have one of the more common species would be Lasius niger, which is the just common black ant that you see around outside your house. And you'll see them in, I think, around July or so. They'll become flying ants. And it's a bit like when a bee's nest swarms. So the queen ant will go out and she'll mate with other male ants, and the flying ants will go off and find a new place to make a nest. I think that's what they're doing anyway.
Well, that's a new fact for me, because I didn't realize that's what the ants were doing when they all start flying around like that. So that's really interesting.
Hmm.
Thank you so much, Nessa. We are finally through the questions. We've had so many comments coming in from so many schools thanking you for all the work that you've done putting this whole series together. We're so grateful, and hopefully we'll be able to get you back again and have more workshops and learn even more about insects.
I would love that. I really enjoyed it. Thank you all for getting so involved and being so enthusiastic.
Excellent. And if anyone has any questions or anything after the webinar, you have mine and Dean's contact details. Someone did ask about where you can find details for Dean's calendar competition. If you go to the Dublin Bay Biosphere website, so it's dublinbaybiosphere.ie, you'll find details there. I think it's in the news section of the website. you'll find details on the competition and how to enter, and they would absolutely love to get all of your pictures in. So do create something and send it in. And again, Nessa does do school visits or webinars specifically to your class on your request. So you can see her email there. You can give her an email, or you can find her through the Heritage in Schools program as well.
Thanks, Eleanor.
Thanks so much, Nessa.
I'm going to take my stunt snails back out to the garden, and I hope you guys will release yours as well. Thanks so much, everyone.
Excellent. Thanks, everyone. Have a nice day. Bye.
Bye.